This lesson introduces us to the concept of probability, and probability is simply the likelihood of something occurring. Probability, as I mentioned, is the likelihood of something occurring, and it can range from 0 to 1. And so if you look at the little chart that we have here, we have a 0 probability that the sun will not rise tomorrow. That's not going to happen, cannot happen. We go a little bit further. We go to, for instance, the odds of drawing, or the probability of drawing a heart from a deck of cards, and there are 4 suits and 52 cards, so in that case that would be 1 out of 4, or 0.25. The odds of getting a heads or a tails on a single coin toss would be 0.5, and the odds of you getting hit by lightning sometime in your lifetime is 0.00033. So you can see that probability again goes from cannot happen to will happen. And we're going to be dealing with probability with almost everything that we do from this point forward in this class. Just like every other topic in statistics, we're going to have a few terms that we need to discuss. The first is the term experiment. An experiment is the process that leads to an occurrence of one and only one of several possible observations. In other words, an experiment might be rolling a die or flipping a coin. The outcome is the result of the experiment. So when you flip a coin, the outcome would be either getting heads or tails. If you flip a die, the outcome would be, if it's a six-sided die, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or 6. And the event is the collection of one or more outcomes of the experiment. So if I roll a die 5 or 6 times, we could have some events. When you're reading your textbook, you will learn that there are 3 different ways of assigning probability. We're going to talk about 2 of them in this slide presentation. The first being classical probability. And with classical probability, the formula is very simple. The probability of an event occurring is the number of favorable outcomes divided by the total number of possible outcomes. Now that'll make a whole lot more sense as we show you the next slide here. So here's how classical probability works. So we're going to do an experiment, we're going to roll a die, and we're going to figure out what is the probability of getting an even number. So the possible outcomes are a 1, a 2, a 3, a 4, a 5, or a 6. We're looking for an even number, so there are 3 favorable, the outcome we're looking for, possible out of a total of 6 possible outcomes. So the probability of getting an even number using classical probability would be 3 divided by 6, 3/6, 1/2, or 0.5, 50% probability of getting an even number. The other thing that's important to understand about classical probability is that each experiment is new. It doesn't matter what's happened in the past, as it does with empirical probability, which is coming up next. With classical probability, let's say you flipped a coin 10 times, and 9 out of the 10 times you got tails. Well, it doesn't matter with classical probability, even though 9 out of 10, there might be something wrong with the coin, but in classical probability, you're going to flip the coin. At that experiment, there is still a 1 in 2 chance that you're going to get a tails or a head. So with classical probability, we don't look at what's happened in the past, only what could happen as a result of this one experiment that we're doing right now. Another important term to understand when we're dealing with probability is the term mutually exclusive. Mutually exclusive means that you can only have an occurrence of one event, and if you have the one, you can't get the other at the same time. In other words, if you throw a coin, you can't get both a head and a tail. You can get one or the other. They are mutually exclusive. All right, we talked about mutually exclusive. Another important term is the concept of independence. Events are independent if the occurrence of one does not affect the ability or the occurrence of another. In other words, if I'm throwing 2 coins, if I get a head on one of the coin, that doesn't prevent me from getting a tail on the other or a head on the other. And that's because the events are independent. All right, we've had mutually exclusive and independent, and now we're going to throw another term at you, and that is collectively exhaustive. Collectively exhaustive means that at least one of the events must occur when an experiment is conducted. In other words, if you have a horse race, there's going to be a winner. If you flip a coin, it's going to be either heads or tails. It is collectively exhaustive because either one or the other, in the case of the coin, must occur. Okay, we've looked at classical probability. Now we have another way of assigning probability, and that's called empirical probability. With empirical probability, we assign probability of an event happening based on what's happened in the past. So we'll go ahead and give you an example of that on the next slide, and that'll make more sense. And in order to do that, we're able to use what's called the law of large numbers. The law of large numbers, as far as empirical probability is concerned, it simply tells us that the more times we try something, the more likely it is to approach its true probability. And that's perfectly true with flipping a coin. If you flip a coin one time, you might get a heads, and you might assume at that point there's a 100% probability of getting a head each time you flip the coin. Of course, that isn't correct, but if you do a number of experiments, you'll see that the more you do it, the more it approaches 0.5, which is what the actual probability is. And we'll see an illustration of that on the next slide. So here you see an example of the law of large numbers at work. Again, the first time you flip a coin, it may or may not get what you're looking for. In this case, we're assumed that the favorable event is getting a heads. Well, the first time you do it, if you didn't get any, you would assume in that case that you had a 0% chance of getting heads. But if you tried it 10 times, 50 times, 100 times, 500 times, 1,000, and then eventually 10,000 times, you would see that the more times you try the experiment, the more likely you are to approach the true probability of that event. So here's an example of empirical probability. The space shuttle, there were two disasters with the space shuttle. And the example that we're given here on this slide is that on February 1st, 2003, the space shuttle Columbia exploded. However, if we wanted to figure out using empirical probability what the possibility, the probability of a space shuttle being successful, we would look at there were 121 successful flights and there were 123 total. So the probability of a successful flight using empirical probability is 0.98. Now using classical probability, we wouldn't take into account what's happened in the past. And so we could say in theory that there's a 50-50 chance. It either would be successful or not be successful. And so you can see that in the long run, using the law of large numbers, empirical probability is probably a little bit more accurate when you're dealing with things or trying to predict things that are a little bit more complex than simply flipping a coin. All right, now that we've got the different ways to approach probability discussed, we need to talk about addition and multiplication of probability. So the first thing we'll talk about is the rule of addition. The special rule of addition says if two events, A and B, or heads or tails, are mutually exclusive, then the probability of either one or the other equals the sum of the probabilities. So the probability of A or B equals the probability of A plus the probability of B. So in flipping a coin, if the probability of getting a head is 0.5 and the probability of getting a tail is 0.5, the probability of getting either a head or a tail is 0.5 plus 0.5, or 100%. Remember that mutually exclusive means that if we get one, we can't get the other. But there's also times when the outcomes are not mutually exclusive. So in a situation where the outcomes are not mutually exclusive, the probability of getting either one or the other is the probability of A or B equals the probability of A, let's say that's 60%, plus the probability of B, which might be 30%, but we have to subtract the intersection where they could select both A and B. So again, the probability of A or B when they're not mutually exclusive, as you see in this Venn diagram here, we have to subtract the intersection of the two outcomes. We will see how both of these work in the upcoming slides here. We'll have some examples for you. So here's an example of mutually exclusive events, and we're trying to figure out the probability of one or the other. So we have a slaw machine that fills plastic bags with a bunch of vegetables. And so down at the bottom of this slide, you see the result. We've done a sample of 4,000 different packages, and we see that 100 of them have been underweight and 300 have been overweight. So if we wanted to know what the probability of having a package that would be either underweight or overweight, we have, in the case where the formula is written out, the probability of A or C, A being underweight, C being overweight, equals the probability of A plus the probability of C, which, as we see with this slide, is 0.25 plus 0.75 or 0.1. So the probability of either A or C, underweight or overweight, is the probabilities added together, and we end up with 0.1. Well, here we see an example of a probability of one or the other when the events are not mutually exclusive. And to do that, we'll use a deck of cards. So we want to know what the probability of choosing a card at random and having it be either a king or a heart. So the probability of getting a king is 4 out of 52. There's 4 kings out of the deck of 52 cards. The probability of getting a heart is 13 out of 52 because there's 4 suits and there's 13 hearts. But in order to see the probability of getting a king or a heart, we have to see that the king of hearts is counted twice, because it would be counted if we got a king. It would also be counted if we got a heart. So with a Venn diagram that you see down at the bottom right of your slide, the intersection would be the king of hearts. So the probability of A or B, again, A being king, B being hearts, is the probability of A plus the probability of B minus the intersection, or in this case, the one that occurs both places, which would be the king of hearts. So that breaks down to 4 divided by 52, 4 52s, plus 13 52 minus 1 52, or when we break it down, the probability of getting a king or a heart is 0.3077, because we have to subtract the intersection of both of those events. All right, we're moving up the math scale. We've talked about addition in probabilities. Now we're going to be talking about multiplication. So the special rule of multiplication requires, first off, that the events be independent. Remember, the events are independent if the occurrence of one has no effect on the probability of the occurrence of the other. So in a situation like that, the rule would be written, the probability of A and B, of getting both A and B, is the probability of A times the probability of B. And we'll go ahead and see an example of that in some upcoming slides. All right, so here's an example of the special rule of multiplication. So with this slide here, the American Automobile Association, AAA, has found that 60% of its members make airline reservations last year. So they decided to survey a couple of members. So they selected one member at random, and they selected another member at random. So what they want to know is, what is the probability that both of those two individuals that they selected at random had made airline reservations in the past? Well, the solution is pretty simple. The probability that the first member made an airline reservation is 0.6, because, again, 60% of their members have made an airline reservation. So we pull the next guy. Well, the probability of that next individual also making an airline reservation is 0.6. But the two together, because we want to know the probability that they both made an airline reservation, is 0.6 for the first one times 0.6 for the second one. So together, the probability that both the first one and the second one had made airline reservations is 0.36. All right, now we're moving into some fun stuff here with probability. And we're moving into the concept of conditional probability. Conditional probability is the probability that a particular event occurs given that or after another event has also occurred. So the probability of event A occurring given that event B has already occurred is written as you see down there in the slide. Probability of A, and we use the little line between the A and B, which stands for given that. And of course, we'll see some examples of that in an upcoming slide. We use the general rule of multiplication to find the joint probability between two non-independent events. And so we write that out as the probability of A and B is the probability of A times the probability of B given that A. And that'll make a lot more sense as we go through the example on the next slide. All right, so here's an example of the general multiplication rule. So suppose a golfer has 12 shirts in his closet. 9 of them are white and 3 are blue. All right, and for some reason he gets dressed in the dark, and so he just kind of grabs a shirt and puts it on. So we want to know, what is the likelihood of both shirts being selected for 2 different days in a row being white? So what is the probability of shirt number 1 being white and shirt number 2 being white? All right, so here we go. It's not as hard as it looks here. So the first day, the probability of a white shirt is 9 out of 12, because again, 9 are white and 3 are blue. The second day, what's the probability of a white shirt? So the probability that white on day 2, given that we had a white on day 1, is 8 out of 11, because we've pulled one of the white shirts out, so therefore there are only 8 white shirts left, and there's only 11 shirts altogether. So to determine the probability of selecting 2 white shirts in a row, the formula is the probability of A and B, A being white shirt day 1, being white shirt day 2, is the probability of A times the probability of B given that A. And we write that out as follows, okay? 9 twelfths times 8 11th, or 0.5. So it's actually a very simple formula to compute this.